Good afternoon, everybody. I'm giving this presentation on behalf of myself and also my student, who is the first author here, and she's also among the audience. So I'll be basically talking on this nanomaterial functionalized metamaterial inspired resonators for ultra sensitive sensing and selective sensing of hydrogen sulfide. This is basically the group, and in this group, Vaishali is the main author of this particular work. She has done the work, and along with few other students and collaborators. The group of mine, quickly I will go through. We work on different kind of sensors, since this is a typical conference exclusively on sensors. We work on CBW, that is chemical and biological warfare diagnostics. We also work on different kind of RF sensors. Low field detections, this is typically for the extremely low field for sonar applications, since we belong to a defense institute. We also work on smart drug delivery and diagnostic tools. So these are the different areas in which we work on by using metal, metal oxides, polymer, polymer composite materials, and envisage them for different kind of application domain. The talk of today, I'll just introduce the topic first. Why do we call them as metamaterial inspired structures used for sensing? I'll try to explain. How do we make the device? What do we do for exclusive sensing of hydrogen sulfide? We do some kind of nanomaterial functionalization. And finally, I'll just show the experimental results and the conclusions. So this particular part, everybody knows, it's not very new, that gas sensing is a major challenge. We have, since the first day of the conference, we have been hearing a lot of lectures on gas sensing. Every time we do talk about selectivity, recovery, high temperature sensing, and so on and so forth. So there are major challenges in the current research related to selectivity issues. These selectivity issues are more prominent if we use metal oxides, because they show typically oxidation and reduction reactions, and then we have to really work a lot to identify which particular gas and how much change in the property of a given metal oxide. Toxic gases like hydrogen sulfide, they are known to be very much toxic, and they are used, they are produced in different industries, which we need to worry about, and therefore H2S sensing is important. Nanomaterials have been around for a long time. In the morning, we have had a very good lecture at a plenary talk, which talks about the use of nanomaterials for different kind of sensing applications. They have been integrated with a microwave metamaterial resonator in this particular work to improve the sensitivity of the sensor. And H2S is only used as a model gas. If we are able to change the nanomaterial, we should be able to change the gas that we are trying to sense. So what are the basically RF sensors? So what are these resonators? So resonators are nothing but the miniaturized sensor structures. I'll just try to quickly explain the resonators. So we call them as metamaterial inspired, because metamaterials are nothing but artificially engineered materials. They are artificially structured, and they come in an array form. And in this array, you are able to tune its properties in such a way that you are able to derive a particular application of it. The materials show permittivity and permeability. It's an interplay of permittivity and permeability. If both of them take up a negative value, then they fall in the category of metamaterials. In this particular case, we use electrical metamaterial, in which the permittivity is something which is manipulated and not the magnetic permeability. So these are highly miniaturized sensor structures. They are resonator based, so they work on a frequency concept. They are extremely sensitive. I'll explain you why they are sensitive as we go ahead. And they are very selective also. They are label free. The response is almost instantaneous, and they are very easy to integrate with the conventional CMOS kind of a technology. So the structures have been used for sensing. There are a lot of papers which do talk about the different applications of these kind of resonators. The resonators are called as splitting resonators, in which you have two rings which are split in such a way that they are equivalent to a combination of inductor and a capacitor to form a resonator circuit. So these are some of the references which talk about the work which people have done earlier to generate microwave regime. People have also worked with resonators, not only in RF range, but also extremely high frequency, that is in infrared regime also. There are different applications in infrared regime, which we don't go into much details. The complementary splittering resonator is exactly opposite. It's just like a negative of a photograph. So this particular structure shows that. So the one which is shown as a white part is actually the substrate. The one which is shown as a brownish part is actually the copper. So this is a copper structure on an FR4 substrate, and you have cut the copper into splittering resonator. It has got multiple parameters such as how much is the distance between the cut rings, how much is the distance between two concentric rings, and so on. And they give rise to an electronic circuitry which is giving you an equivalent circuit diagram which looks like this. The structure size is very less, and the resonance wavelength can be represented in terms of this particular circuit diagram. Before we do a particular sensor, we do a good amount of modeling about the structure. So essentially what you have is you have a copper clad. On the top of it, you actually have the structure, and below that you actually have a microstrip line. So through this microstrip line is a line through which you give the input, and the structure on the top, it works as a structure which gives you the different kind of resonance effect. That is what is shown here. So this is the line which is below. This is a microstrip line. This is a structure on the top, and we just have to ensure that how much are the parameters that we use to make up the resonator circuit, and how much is the thickness of the substrate. Using all this, we need to model the structure. Once we model, we are able to find out how much is the resonant frequency, and this is how the structure looks like. And on the back side, you will have the microstrip line. We get an extremely good resonant frequency, and this particular frequency changes as you subject it to some kind of a sensing environment. This sensing environment is given by merely dropping the corresponding liquid that you want to sense. What happens is that as it falls on the sensing bed, the dielectric medium around this particular sensor changes, thereby changing the resonant frequency. Depending upon the type of liquid, the dielectric constant of it, naturally the signature is unique for every different liquid that we want to sense. So that's how it is done. This is the way in which the resonant frequency is calculated, and that's how the sensor works without functionalization. Now if we want to functionalize it to ensure that it is still more selective for a particular gas, then this is what we do. So we designed a structure using the simulation software. After that, we optimize a parameter so that we are able to fix a particular frequency. Then fabricate a sensor using a conventional photolithography. And the sensor testing is done using a vector network analyzer, and we test it with different chemicals. Now, if we want to do something more, then we have to do the functionalization. That part comes the next. So this is how the parameters are fixed, and this is how it looks like if you use, I think, COMSOL as a simulation software. And these are the parameters that were chosen to ensure that the frequency was around 2.45 gigahertz. Once this was done, this is how the experimental setup looks like, where you have a vector network analyzer, you give a frequency of 2.45 gigahertz, and you see the output, the resonant frequency, you do see it to be 2.45 gigahertz aroundish. This is a place where you put the sensor. Now, the gold nanoparticles are used for improving the selectivity. This is done by making gold nanoparticles and functionalizing them on the sensor bed. So, how it is done? Conventional gold nanoparticles are synthesized. I don't go into the details of it. It is simply done by using chloroauric acid and using the reduction reaction. We make gold nanoparticles. A typical signature is seen of the gold as a signature of gold. It is also checked by using EDAX and also using imaging. And then that is simply functionalized on the FR4 substrate by simply doing a spin coating on the top of the sensor bed. So this whole thing actually shows the same thing, and then you put the sensor and expose it to the H2S gas. By putting in this particular beaker, this simple reaction is put, and H2S as it is evolved, you are exactly able to measure the ppm quantity, and that is what interacts with the sensor bed. The moment you do that, this is what you get, which shows the good selectivity of the sensor. So you have the complementary split ring resonator, and with only the resonator with H2S gas, it is shown as this block, black color block, which shows you the sensitivity. This is the resonance shift. So the moment you put it, you get the resonance shift. The shift is very small, as you can see. If you use CSRR with gold nanoparticles and hydrogen sulfide, you really get a very good shift. This shift is of the order of around 50 to 52 megahertz in the 2.45 gigahertz frequency range. And if you use only CSRR and gold nanoparticles along with oxygen, again, you do not get good data, because it's basically everybody knows that hydrogen sulfide, the sulfur, is loved by gold. So naturally, when you have gold nanoparticles, they will have special affinity towards sulfur, and therefore you get a very good signature for sulfur and not for oxygen. That is how you ensure selectivity by using a proper. So this is what is actually shown, and it tells you how hydrogen sulfide interacts with the gold nanoparticles, thereby giving you a specific selectivity of sulfur using this. This is the last slide, which just talks about the way in which interaction may happen when you consider CSRR and gold nanoparticles interacting with hydrogen sulfide. You do see the change in the morphology. Now, I will not say that this AFM result shows anything much more, but it only shows a change in the morphology. We do not derive any specific conclusion out of AFM studies. However, we just want to show that since there is an interaction, you see the corresponding change in the morphology. We don't attribute it much to anything. So finally, the conclusion is that a sensitive and a selective microwave H2S sensor is demonstrated. This can be considered as a first step towards microwave-based sensor, which can be made more better, faster, and more selective. I would like to tell everybody that anyway, when you consider RF sensors, they are anyway very, very selective as compared to any other conventional sensor. But they can be made better by using nanomaterial functionalization. These inspired structures, they are integrated with gold nanoparticles for selectivity. The concentration as low as 1 ppm can also be measured, and as high as 100 ppm can also be measured. Cross selectivity can be checked with other gases also. We did it for this particular work only with oxygen. So that's what is the final conclusion. Let me thank on behalf of my group. Typically, I would like to mention Vaishali, who has done the work here in this particular problem. She has worked along with many others who stand here, along with Babli, who is now in Germany. She is doing her PhD. And thank you on behalf of them and myself. Thank you.